And it was very easy, I think, because it's very hard, I think, to penetrate Chinese culture and Chinese people if they keep speaking Chinese and do things in secret. Plus, the Chinese society is much easier to operate in, you know, if you want to do anything secretly clandestine, because they have secret prisons and they can do all kinds of stuff. There's much more autocratic management. And I think what happened is that China succeeded. China succeeded in showing force that is unmitigatable by the U.S. So now you have two things. You have two. So China is able to beat the U.S. the shit out of the U.S. if they wanted to, and that China might get hurt itself, but it would also damage the U.S. severely. That has to be the case. It cannot be the case that that's not an issue at all. Otherwise, things that we see right now that are happening wouldn't be happening. And so what you have is you have a two-edged sword that is, let's say, hanging above the world or swinging around. The one edge is that the world wants, that parts of the world want to enforce their lifestyle. And in order to do so, they will fight. So the U.S. wants to enforce its lifestyle against China. And to do so, it will end up in a nuclear war with China. And China the other way around. China might attack the U.S. Or China might attack Japan. Or all these kind of things can happen. You get a massive war. And as a result of this massive war, you get massive lethality, death of people, destruction. World economy grinds to a halt. Food supply grinds to a halt. Everything stops, and it's going to be very quiet because it's a nuclear exchange. There's not horseshit, something like that. So that's the one edge of the sword. The other edge of the sword is that you suddenly run out. You keep the lifestyle going, and you suddenly run out of all your oil, and you run out of everything you need. Because think of something that you really need every day, and you cannot get anywhere else. You know that you cannot supply yourself. Well, there's lots of it. It's bread and butter and milk and eggs. Usually, you don't have chickens. But some of these things are you can deal with it. One thing you can't deal with is no electricity, no oil, no gas. And you cannot get it anywhere else than at the oil companies at the price that they fixed for you to consume it. You are basically a rabbit in a cage, being fed nice carrots every day. Face it, that's the reality. You know, if you want to deny that, you have to go solar, clean, independent. You have to have your own water supply, your own fuel supply. You have to be completely cut off from the outside world. So you can look at it from two ways. One is you're being set upon by a rent seeker, which is true, which is the greedy banker that has been used as a tool to basically distribute the oil and energy and the food, and that has basically gone crazy. It went to its head. He believed that he did something special. He does nothing special. The other way around is that you look at it and say, well, no, you yourself have not tried to be independent. You are not autonomous. That's crazy, historically, evolutionarily seen. Monkeys in the forest, they're more independent than you. You know, a rat is more independent than you. You are basically a rabbit in a cage, a nice white rabbit. But so the other edge of the sword is that the oil will stop, everything will stop, and you have nothing to deal with that situation. And of course, you can organize and you can stand in line and wait for somebody to give you food. But the food comes from a farmer. The farmer needs the oil. He cannot farm. The land is dead. You cannot grow. So, you know, you cannot grow and there's no food. Everybody starves. And that's it. for some times. So the two edges of the sword, or one of them, is war on a global scale. The other one is global famine. Both will cause massive amounts of people dying. Now, that's the real situation. That's the real quandary that we're in. Now, how will you deal with that as a government or as a society? Well, you want to get rid of these bankers. Oh, desperately get rid of the people that believe that competition and growth is the key to the future, to improvement. They don't realize that you need oil to do that, and they have no inclination or consideration for the fact that in order to get the oil, you have to kill other people, or you have to deny them life, either one of them. In the short term or in the long term, that's what has to happen. Because if these societies develop as white rabbits in cages, you know, very nice. You know, you have to protect them. At least if you are a moral person. So what you need to do is you have to wind it down. You have to wind it down. There's another reason for it, that's climate change, that's because oil is poison in the atmosphere. But just if you're faced with a double-edged sword of either war and massive death or starvation and massive death, you have to start winding down the system. And that's what's been happening, I think. That's what we are seeing. But as it is winding down, you know, there are choices that you can make. Who's going to be hurt the first? Who's going to be easiest to get off, you know? Which rabbit is strong enough to release? Which rabbit can you throw out and won't be eaten immediately? Which are the non-white ones? Which are the colored ones? The ones with the more camouflage? See, that's and the bankers also play a game. They play a game that under the circumstances that have been created, with the speculative bubble and all that stuff, and that being force-fed by the Federal Reserve, in order to kill it, you know, all kinds of dynamics can go on and happen, which is simply about people being smart. But how are you ever going to manage that without showing the real game that's going on, the real play that's been happening? You know, what if somebody said, you know, Ireland might object, but you know, so you don't starve the powerfuls, because they object and they make it impossible to execute the whole process. You know, so you start with Ireland and the BRICS, and you start with whatever part of the US or the world that is weak enough. Now, other countries might not be on board with it. I actually think that a lot of countries are on board with it. That there is a lot of countries that understand this. You know, if you are the real leadership of a country, you understand that you have created populations of dependent people. And you should go back to populations of independent people. And that will be a painful process, but it's not less natural than, you know, when you would not be around. Right now, people have a lot of protection. So they're protected by their governments, by the police, by the oil supply, by the farmers that farm. They make almost no money. You know, all these things happen in order to protect the white rabbit. What the white rabbit needs to learn is that he might suck at being a rabbit, and he doesn't belong in the world, or he's a brilliant, he's a very strong one, and he might survive outside the cage. You know, and that is a painful process, and in that process, all kinds of things might be said. And that's like, but this, I think, is the overarching reality of the situation. And of course, this is not because I always talk about this, but of course, you realize that if you replace oil, if you replace gas, and if you replace coal by something like alternative energy, you won't have a problem in this transition. And at the moment, the bankers are still dominating the scene, and the oil companies are still dominating the scene, while they're trying to, while they're basically being destroyed. And so you won't hear that enough. But that's also, that's a massive component of let's say, the middle part of the sword. And it still will hit you pretty hard. You know, if somebody hits you with that sword, with the side, but it won't chop off your head. And I think it's pretty good that people are trying to do it that way. You know, we would have been in a war a long time ago if it weren't the case.